Look, it's been an incredible journey, and my foray into cricket, a sport that I played at a very high level, but also a sport that I love dearly, which I always wanted to give back to and contribute to. So given my sort of medical background, I was in a perfect opportunity to still be involved with a sport that I love, but still be able to contribute to it and then travel with it. So Surrey gave me my first opportunity for 4 years in the late 90s, early 2000s, and that was an incredible period of my life because it was a winning start and it was a very successful team in the late 90s Surrey County Cricket and with a really good bunch of guys. And then to go from there to Bangladesh was really interesting because it was almost the opposite. It was going to a team that had only just got their test status, so there was no structure, there was not a lot in place. So it allowed me to sort of dive into the deep end of international cricket, which was really exciting, and be tested and be challenged in an environment that was not only new to international cricket, but was also very, it's difficult for a foreigner to enter Bangladesh and contribute. So I was able to really make a mark there, which I appreciated the opportunity to do so. And then the transition into Indian cricket was actually therefore a lot easier because I'd had the Bangladesh experience. And again, coming into India at a time of a lot of changes, you know, the period that I was there, we had a number of different captains from Ganguly to Dravid to Kumble to Dhoni. And then from a management perspective, there were lots of changes. But again, it gave me a platform to try and introduce some of the new ways of thinking around sport in India, but also particularly cricket in India. And seeing the big picture was that in order to compete with your Australians and some of the other teams, we had to improve in some key areas, and fitness was one of those areas. So fitness became a really big thing for me. And then the opportunity to work with a team like Rajasthan Royals allowed me to then take that to the next level because it's such a concentrated tournament. I was then able to put a lot more things into place that I feel and I hope has contributed to the sort of the mantra that's still around at Rajasthan Royals and I hope can continue. I went on a pretty different path actually, but when I first left school I actually didn't really know what I wanted to do, so I took a year off and travelled, as a lot of Australians tend to do. So I travelled overseas, came back, and I actually wanted to do law. So I ended up doing a Bachelor of Arts and I majored in geophysics and geomorphology, believe it or not. So again, moved away from the law side of it, moved more into the arts and sciences. And then when I finished that, I wasn't really, again, sure what I wanted to do. My mum had been a physio, so I had an insight into physio at the time, and I thought, well, that's an interesting way for me to now perhaps go back into the sporting field and take my love of medicine with it. So, yeah, so I became a physio, and it's a tough degree. In Australia, it's a very tough degree. So it's 4 years plus 1 year postgrad. But I think it's the best decision I ever made because it's opened up opportunities to me that would never have been there. And that's not just in the sporting sense, but in the sense of being able to travel, experience all the cultures around the world, work with some of the greatest players who've ever been involved in the game, from your Tendulkars to Dravids to Watsons to Smiths to... And also be involved with the people around the game, and some of the people that are in the commentary box are my dearest friends who've also contributed to the game in incredible ways. And then also to be able to interact at the level above that with all the medical staff, and that's allowed me to grow as a clinician but also as a person. So for me, I've got a lot to thank the physiotherapy profession for and the sports medical profession. So I'm forever grateful for sort of moving down that path. Yeah, I think the interesting thing is that we now need to look at Indian sport, step back and look at it from the outside. And consistently we've been asked questions about why are we not getting the outcomes in other sports outside of cricket that we should be with the population that's in India and the potential talent that's in this country. And I think one of the reasons that I've certainly highlighted is the fact that we don't have a sport culture amongst our kids, and it's not encouraged within the school sports system. So I'm very fortunate to be involved at a very high level with with Kooh Sports, which is a sports education platform, delivering sports education programs and curriculums to kids. Because I believe until we can change the kids, give them the foundation of sport or even the foundation of just physical literacy, and do that well, then we won't get the sports outcomes later on in life. Because if you don't have those skills and you don't acquire those motor competence and physical literacy skills by the time you're 10 or 11 years of age, you never acquire them. So the sporting outcomes for the country are going to be limited unless we address that problem. And we can do that through the school system. I also think we need to, again, look at the bigger picture of the health and wellness of our nation, and our nation being India. And I believe that unless we address the sport and physical issues of our children, we will continue to have health problems as we get older as adults here as well. So we can kill two birds with one stone, I believe, by me being involved at that level, at the grassroots level, at the school level. So that's been very rewarding, and that's allowed me a platform to voice my other great love, which is health and nutrition. So I'm using sport as a vehicle to gain outcomes for other agendas, and I think that's really, really important. I always say that I appreciate that Mr. Modi, our Prime Minister, has the skill initiative, but I believe we should be skilling our children. And I think the greatest gift we can give our children is to skill them with the gift of physical literacy, because that will set them up for life. So that's been a big thing for me. I also am very fortunate to sit on the advisory board and have a role as the head of sports science and sports medicine for the Go Sports Foundation, an incredible foundation out of Bangalore run by some incredible people who are looking at nurturing the next generation of Indian Olympians. And we identified that a lot of their sports science and sports medical support was lacking throughout the country. So we're trying to build an ecosystem to help the next generation of athletes do that. And with some wonderful people on that board, Rahul Dravid, Gopi Chand, Abhinav Bindra, Nandan Kamath, to name a few, we are in a position to affect change. And we've seen that in some of the results of some of our Paralympians, as well as our able-bodied Olympians in the last two Olympics, as well as in the recent Asian Games and at Commonwealth Games. So I feel that that system is now maturing as well. We need to mature along with that system, but I think in some small way, again, we've contributed to changing the face of Indian sport. Yeah, if you look at the modern game of cricket, it's a completely physical game. You can't hide in modern cricket anymore, especially in the T20 arena. You know, the sport is underpinned now by an extremely robust fitness platform. And the key component to fitness is nutrition. And if you don't have the nutrition part right, as hard as you may try, you'll never get the fitness part right. So nutrition has become a very big focus for us. And the thought around nutrition and the science around nutrition has changed over the last sort of 10 years or so. So I think it's very important that we now embrace change, and we embrace change that is backed by good science and good research. So for me, educating our players at every level, particularly amongst the children around nutrition, because if we can give them the good nutritional habits as children, they will then carry them forward into adulthood, and again alleviate some of the burden on the health system going forward. So that's a big driver for me. I try and educate and lecture as many as I can around nutrition, not just sports people, but parents as well as children. But the modern day cricketer and the modern day athlete appreciates that unless we get that part of their game right, the other parts will not fall into place. So recovery, performance, long-term health outcomes are really important, weight control, and cognitive function are all backed by nutrition or the correct nutrition. And there's been a lot of information out there which has been around for a long time, which is clearly wrong when it comes to nutrition, and we've got it wrong. And I think if you look broadly across India, but across the world as well, it's gone wrong because the outcomes are increasing rates of obesity, increasing rates of diabetes, increasing rates of cardiovascular disease. And it's become an epidemic. And until we identify the source of that, which we now have, we're going to struggle not just in our sports outcomes and performance, but also with the general health and well-being of Indian society, but also the burden on the current health system. So nutrition for me is absolutely a number one priority, but it has to be nutritional advice that is backed by good science and good research. There's some very poor science out there. There's some very largely manipulated studies which make it to the press, which are completely wrong. And when you dig a little deeper, a lot of these studies are completely flawed. A lot of these studies you'll see are funded by various large institutions that have vested interests. So you need to be very careful about following the money trail when it comes to looking at research, especially in the field of nutrition. So that's an area that we need to improve on, and it's an area that I'm hoping that I can further contribute going forward, not just for the athletes, but also more importantly for the children and for the general population. Look, for me, I'm a big proponent of what we call real food, and I think we've got to go back to real foods. We've got to move away from processed foods. We have to move away from the high sugar diets, which are predominantly dominating our space, especially the children's health space. My diet is simple. Like I said, it's what I would call a real food diet. I don't take any sugars. And if you were to sort of bracket it in any bracket, I'm probably in what we call the low carbohydrate, healthy fat sort of a mantra. But you got to understand that everybody's different. And the more knowledge now that we have, especially around particular blood markers that we're now using, we're now better able to sort of program diets for various people that are more effective. So I think, again, that comes on the back of education, it comes on the back of good science and good research. But I think for me, it's pretty easy to see the changes when you have a good diet. And if the two words that you take out of this whole thing are real food, then I'll be more than happy, because I think if we can go back to that, the basics of eating real food and not eating food out of a packet or out of a box or out of a Tetra pack or drinking things out of cans and packets, then I think we're going to be in a much, much better place. So let's start to be better educated around what is good, what are the healthy alternatives that are out there. And fortunately, you know, there are products that are coming onto the market that I believe are good options. And so there's a big move towards being more organic in India now, and I think that's wonderful. And I think we need to be sort of moving towards the sort of the more organic real food direction, and that's certainly the direction that I've taken. I get asked this question a lot about breakfast, and you know, my mum always used to say that breakfast is the most important meal of the day, and I think in a lot of cases it is, and certainly for children I still think it is. I'm not convinced it still is for adults, because there's a lot of science and research out there now about the benefits of things like intermittent fasting, with some serious sound science behind it, which means eating your last meal at say 7 PM the day before and not eating again till early afternoon the next day. And there's a lot of health benefits to that, especially around insulin sensitivity and fine-tuning your system. So in that case, then breakfast is not always necessary. But if you are going to have breakfast, then breakfast has to be one, again, that is based around real foods. What we always use to term a healthy breakfast, so, and I've given this example many times, is that, you know, a glass of juice, a bowl of cereal, a couple of slices of toast, and a low-fat yogurt. Well, what people don't realize is that not only is that very poor nutritionally, but there's also the equivalent of about 20 to 22 teaspoons of sugar in a supposedly healthy breakfast. So given what we now know, and moving back towards some of the more real breakfast options, we're moving more away from, again, the packaged processed breakfast. So for me, breakfast involves eggs, the whole egg. There's never been and still has no research showing the link between dietary cholesterol and cardiovascular disease. So we're now moving back towards our whole egg options. We're moving towards the healthy fat options. So for me, eggs are a big part of my breakfast. Avocado is a big part of my breakfast. A full fat dairy is a big part of my breakfast, along with berries, so good berry options. So I think the one thing about being in India is a lot of very good vegetarian options that are real foods. So for the vegetarians and the pure vegetarians, there's still a lot of options available to eat healthily and have a healthy breakfast. So start doing some more research, start investigating what's out there, and start doing more search around the dangers of sugars and the dangers of hidden sugars, especially in the breakfast meal, and particularly for children. Because if children are being fueled by sugar in the morning, 2 hours later they're gonna want to be refueled again, because that's the nature of sugars. So consistently through the whole day, they're just going through ups and downs. So huge negative effects on concentration, huge negative effects on the ability for a child to retain information. And sugar is highly inflammatory. So children become very irritable, they become susceptible to disease, to injury. And if they're sports people, they don't recover at all. So a diet that's fueled by sugar or very high in carbohydrates, especially processed carbohydrates, is not a diet that is beneficial for the elite athlete as well. So we've now moved towards a number of combinations of looking at diet, but again, all based around blood reports and blood markers that give us information as to how you will respond to certain food groups. So I think that all starts at breakfast, but also don't be, or more so, be aware that there are other options out there that do not include breakfast as well. I'm a big fan of nut butters, and I'm a big fan because it gives me options. I've mentioned before that we're now identifying what are the healthy fats and what are the not healthy fats. And the healthy fats are in nuts. And I think if we can extract them in any form, then I think that's really important. I believe it's a very efficient fuel source. We know the benefits of being a fat-fueled athlete, as well as a fat-fueled person. There's health benefits to that, and there's performance benefits to that, especially anyone in the endurance sports. Cricket is an endurance sport at the end of the day. So a lot of our players are using the nut butters pre-match as an energy boost, with great effect. For me, one of my favorite meals is toasted almond bread. With the nut butter on top, that's a really good snack for me. And again, a lot of the players are now using that as a snack pre-match. So what you need to be aware of is that we now still need to look at organic products, and even more so now with some of the adulteration that's happening in food products across the world. We're now going back to real food discussion again. We need to look at sugar contents, and I think the unsweetened options that we have through this medium is really, really important, especially for children. And knowing that the healthy fats that nuts offer are crucial for brain development, for cognitive development, but also for performance and recovery. I think, you know, if you want to look at something that's quick, it's easy and accessible as a not just a food option, but a recovery option and a performance option, then I think it's a really, really important thing to look at. And so, you know, these guys have done an amazing job at packaging this. But I've often said that the smart consumer doesn't necessarily look at the front of the packet anymore. They're starting to look at the back of the packet. And on the back of the packaging is where the information around the nutrition component is. And I think what you'll find in these products is that the nutrition component stands alone. And it certainly has my endorsement as to what is healthy in a product. And I believe that the smarter we get, the more we're going to be looking at the back of the label and understanding exactly what's in that product before we purchase it. And for me, these tick all the boxes. My favorite nut butter, I'm a big fan of just your good old crunchy peanut butter, I think. And I think that is probably because as kids, you know, we did grow up with it. But the other one that's sort of really taken my fancy of late has been the cashew, because the consistency and the texture is amazing. And a lot of kids also love it as well. And I know that my son, he's 8 years old, very active sports person. And for him to go to the fridge, stick the spoon in and take a spoonful of any of them, the almond butter, the peanut, the cashew, he's a big fan as well. And I think that's the start of the education process for the child. And I think this is contributing to me being able to educate my child that this is a healthy option and something else is not. So kids are now then, through various products, able to identify what is good for them and what is not.